The theme of the scientific session 4 is occupational therapy practices in India, perception and evidence. So we are delighted to have chairperson for this session, Dr. Jyotika Vijlani. And I don't think she requires any introduction, but I'm formally introducing her for this session. She is a Dean Econ. She's an organizing secretary of OTCON 2021. She is superannuated as professor and head from LTMMC College and Sion Hospital at Mumbai. She has been EC member and she has served AIOTA in multiple capacities, and she has been awarded with fellowship, fellow of Academic Council, Professional Excellence Award, Crown of OT Award, Vocational Excellence Award by Rotary Club recently in February. She's been panelist, faculty member, guest lecturer in numerous national and international conferences, and authored many research publications. She is our own Jyotika Vijlani, ma'am, and she's specialized in neonatal therapy. If we can call her mother of NICU in Mumbai, I think I would not be wrong in saying so. Welcome, ma'am, to chair the session. I would request Jyotika Vijlani, ma'am, to introduce our faculty speaker, Dr. Harshvardhan.
Yes, Dr. Harshvardhan. Thank you, Shriyesh, for introducing me, and welcome all my delegates and presenters, and especially today's faculty speaker, Dr. Harshvardhan, who is also a chairperson in this session. So, Dr. Harshvardhan, I think he also doesn't need any introduction, because we have been inviting him regularly in our OT programs, because he's a very good speaker and is full of knowledge. But again, I have to introduce him formally. He was a former president of National Occupational Therapy Association of New Zealand. And that time he was so young that we all got so happy. We were so happy in IOTA that we gave him a Young Achievement Award, IOTA's Young Achievement Award, because at such a young age, he was the president of National Occupational Therapy Association. So that was a great job. He did it. And he's also now at present a board member of International Chapter of IOTA and peer reviewer of IJOT. He's a program manager for Family and Community Health Services of the Ministry of Health. He manages the cross-agency vital alcohol spectrum disorder from action plan of New Zealand. He's over a decade, he has got experience more than a decade as a clinician, as a manager, as a leader. And Harsh has a special interest in governance and contemporary healthcare leadership, advocacy, disability, educating, including ASD. Yeah, that is such an important thing. And autism and dyspraxia and sensory processing. So whatnot, everything he has experience, and he's been, that's why at such a young age, he's been considered to be in the ministry. He enjoys mentoring and nurturing young practitioners and future leaders. So young practitioner, you're also a young practitioner, but I'm very happy, Harshvardhan, to be with us today. And let us, over to you, Dr. Harshvardhan. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Vijlani ma'am has said all the serious stuff about me. I've got a last sentence in my first slide, which says, other than all serious stuff, I like to get into nonsense, to have a giggle and fun. I think that is most important part of any practitioner. And it's very important to take care of ourselves and enjoy life as it comes. Now, the first slide is on activity analysis. I do not know, now this takes me around 20 years back. Here you go, Vijlani ma'am was saying I'm a young therapist. Now I'm going 20 years back when I was in first year of my practice. First year occupational therapy student. And we had this activity analysis part, and we were given some activities to do. And one of those was block design. So we had to cut potatoes and make blocks out of them. And then we had to imprint a design. And then we had paper mache activity, which is just sitting next to that in this slide. And I remember when we were doing that, it was quite embarrassing. And especially our physio colleagues and physio friends and P&O friends, and they used to make fun of us saying, what do you guys do there? You know, you make a block design and paper mache. Now, that was quite an insightful activity to do, I must say. At that time, it was looking funny and we could not make any sense of it at all, why we were doing it. But of course, it gave us the skill to break components of activities and then to see how skilled we are to do those things. So for example, if you see range of motion, muscle testing and all that. Now, here I want to ask especially students who are listening to this. I know some of you would be watching the recording and also practitioners, especially new grad practitioners who are in practice. Did you ever think about doing similar activity analysis of how the professional life will look like when you will get into practice, when you will start working as an occupational therapist, or even start doing masters, right? Did you think about how you will get to work? Will you drive? You will catch a bus? You will catch an auto rickshaw? Or what you will do? Or did you think about how you are going to, where you're going to live, where you're going to work? Now, I'm saying these things because these things are very important, and I'll talk about these things in the coming slides, because when you pass out from a university or a college, your success as an occupational therapist not only relies on the academic skills you have got, it relies on many other things. And it is equally important to, if you have not done such kind of activity analysis for yourself, I would encourage you to go tonight and think about how will life look like when you will be in practice. I'll go to the next slide. I've got some points written here so that I have a habit of waffling. So I like telling stories, but I want to stick to the time today. And that's why I've got some points and I'll stick to it. Now, the world is linear. When I think of healthcare education, I am including occupational therapy here. Most of the time we think that the world is linear. So A leads to B and B leads to D and C leads to D. Even if you look at, I remember my NCERT book for the first time when we were taught about what is scientific approach to learning. And they talk about you identify the problem and then you go step-wise to solve the problem. And I'll give an example here. Now, recently we had our second child and he was admitted in ICU for 10 days. So we had to stay there. Now, this was the same hospital where I used to work back then. I was project manager and my job was to make sure the health services provided by the hospital was up to mark. But of course, when I went in the ICU, I did not tell them that I worked for this hospital. So I came across a young pediatrician and immediately they wanted to take blood out of our baby because they wanted to do some kind of blood testing. And what happened is that this person, he was desperate to take the blood out. But our baby was hungry. He wanted to be fed. And it would have taken barely, 1 or 2 minutes or 5 minutes for a baby to feed. But in his mind, he was thinking, no, taking out blood is an unpleasant experience. So, and feeding is a pleasant experience. So he wanted to save a pleasant experience to follow the unpleasant experience. So he said, once I take out the blood, and then we'll give him a pleasant experience, and then that'll be good for the child. Now in that process, it took around 20 minutes to find the nerve of the vein of my child. And of course we had to wait. So this mentality of, you have to go step by step, step one, step two, step three, step four, and that is where the problem lies of our education system. Because I'll go to the next slide here. And sometimes we think the world is, it has got multiple causation and absolutely right, it is there. But when you will go into the real world, especially in the new healthcare landscape, it looks like this. It's a complete mess, isn't it? It's not anything. If you will try to look for step one, step two, step three, you will never be able to negotiate it. I remember when the first time COVID hit, and we have got a group of school friends on WhatsApp, and we were discussing about COVID. And I remember one of my friends who is a very successful medical practitioner back home in India, and he was like, oh, it's just a small thing, it will go away. Well, he was thinking from a medical perspective, and he was thinking it's a small flu-like thing which will go away. But look at this, COVID stayed. And it is not only related to health. When you start looking for solutions for COVID, it actually, the solutions lie, most of them, outside health. And this is just an example to show that how the contemporary landscape is, it's more kind of a complex adaptive system. I'll get into it in the coming slides. Now, tips and tricks to thrive in the new landscape. Look, I don't have a magic wand. I will not say that you will follow this and that is all it is. And that's why I have put that disclaimer there, which says the list is not exhaustive. And you can start with this list and you can add your own things as you go ahead. First one, systems thinking. So the real world does not work from a linear perspective. It does not work like step one goes to step two, goes to step three, step four. And if you look at, now COVID is the most talked about topic these days. If you look at that, and you will see, well, if a few years back, if you talk to people about systems thinking, and if you talk to them that solutions of healthcare lie outside health system, not always it is part of health system, people would have laughed at you. But here comes COVID, and with this exponential change which has taken place, and the world has realized that if you want to fight it, it has to be a systems response. Now this picture, I Googled it, but it is from Department of Health and Family Welfare website in India. And you see in that picture, you cannot only see doctor, you are able to see policemen, you are able to see cleaners and name the profession and it is there. So systems response. Similarly, in the contemporary healthcare, it's not about only health. If you are a health practitioner, you have to think about how you're going to fit in with other people. I lead this program called FASD Action Plan, it's Fetal Alcohol Action Plan. And fetal alcohol is basically when mothers drink during pregnancy, children are born with fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. And basically these children, the disability extends until they are adult. And most of them, unfortunately, would end up in justice system, will be in prison, will commit crimes. And that's why our response is quite system-based. And if you will see this, if you'll go on New Zealand Ministry of Health website, you will see we have got a Ministry of Education involved, we have got prison system involved, we have got police involved. And this action plan looks from a systems perspective, how we can change things. So, and for example, in your context, if you have got a clinic, say a pediatric clinic, now you have to think of, are you there only to give pediatric therapy or can you do some other things? Well, there was a very good presentation from Dr. Raviraj just now, and he was talking about library and how he changed that. And this is just another example. So he went beyond his clinic. He actually went into the library and worked on that, how library can be modified. So systems thinking is like a complex adaptive system. And you have to think about how you can improve healthcare practices by that system-based response. Now, hard and soft skills. Now, driving a car, right? Before I came to New Zealand, no one ever said to me that driving is so important. Well, you know, driving a car or here when I came, I think the most important part as an OT is to have a driving license and to be able to drive. If you're not able to drive, you will never be able to go to work, right? And why here in say in Mumbai, in say in New Delhi, if you do not know how to drive, you will not be able to do private practice properly. You will rely on public transport, which may not help you. So is this a skill you should be considering to learn if you do not know as a student? Should we be telling these things to students so that when they are in the, taking 4 and 5 years of studying in colleges, they are aware that these things are going to come in future? Handling cash. First time when I became president of the OT Association here, I realized that how important it is to know, to learn how to do financial budget, how to learn to read profit and loss sheet, managing a business, learning to speak and to communicate well. And this is very, very important. And it's not just you have to learn only to speak in English, right? It can be Marathi, it can be Odia, it can be Tamil, it can be any language. Basically, you have to think of which is your consumer, and then you have to prepare yourself for that. Writing, if I'll show you, you may think I'm just making up, but look, this is a year 9 grammar book. And you'd be thinking, what this is doing on my desk? When I joined the job in the ministry, it didn't take me long to realize that, look, my English is not that bad. It is okay, right? But then I realized I have to do briefings for ministers. And sometimes I have to do it for prime minister. And to be up to mark, you have to improve your writing skills. No matter how much therapy you can give, but if you cannot provide a standard report for your client, which is suitable for the client, it's not going to work. So these are the skills we have to consider when you're thinking about getting into onboarding, that means getting into practice. And of course, having a network. Networking is very important. And so I can talk and talk about this slide, but I think it would be good if we move ahead. Change is inevitable. And how the globally, how the landscape of healthcare is that gradually we are moving into transdisciplinary space. So, you know, intradisciplinary is when all the disciplines are practicing separately. Multidisciplinary is that they work closely. Transdisciplinary is basically when all the boundaries are going to be blurred. And this is going to happen in coming months. It has already started. In coming months and years, you would have seen that in COVID happening. As an OT, you would have been asked to do things which is not your core skill, but still you have to do. So going forward, you have to think of which skills you want to reserve for yourself and which are the skills you can share with others. And that diagram shows, you know, change cycle, and any new change comes, people react in different ways. I remember talking to occupational therapists in New Zealand about transdisciplinary practice, and I could see how different people take different time in different phase of that change cycle. So being empathetic to people if they're taking more time to understand the need. Power of network. Now, power of network, most of you would already, you know, be good at doing, and you're already doing it. I know some of us are not comfortable in networking on social media, but I think going forward, this is going to be quite important, especially platform revolution and how platforms will get used in healthcare. And there is a 1.5 hour talk. There's a link, YouTube link there. You're most welcome to go and watch that. And this is we did for IOTA, I think a couple of months back, but you can go and just listen to that, what it talks about. Now, this is quite important. You know, healthcare has evolved with time. There was a time when you give any free healthcare service that was okay and people were happy with that. And then we started to talk about quality, and then we started to talk about evidence-based practice in the 90s, right? Going forward, it is more about, yes, evidence is there, but is that adding value? So keeping in mind that whatever your services you provide, for example, knee surgery, evidence is there, you replace the knee and it starts working. But if your client, the goal is to be able to do gardening, the client will never be able to squat with a new, fresh, you know, steel knees and do the work. So it's very important to know that evidence, when you're looking at, you have to consider, is that evidence going to serve the purpose or the value? Improvement science. Now, you know, as I say, big bang waterfall approach is outdated. This is basically, you know, improvement size is a cycle of PDSAs: plan, do, study, and act. For example, you know, you are setting up your pediatric clinic, and you thought, oh, let's do sensory integration therapy training, that may work. And then you do it, and then you start implementing sensory integration therapy. And then you study and see, has that increased referrals to your services? And then you see, no, it's not changing actually. There are other people out there who are doing similar trainings and they have got their sensory integration setups. Now, again, you have to plan. You have to see, okay, then can I do something else? Can I start doing, say, autism diagnostic test, or can I do Griffiths for global developmental assessment? And then you go through that cycle again. And after, say, 2-3 months, you might see, oh, that has not worked either. What about I can have an after school care, and where children will be picked up from their school, given intervention, and so that parents do not have to worry about transport. So you plan, you do it again, you study, and you act. So there's a continuous cycle of improvement. And as you see in the other diagram, the small cycles going forward, keeping that in mind. In our FASTX plan, which I lead here for the ministry, we are doing a similar kind of intervention for assessment of an intervention for FASD, fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. And it's like 6.5 million project. And when we thought who should do this, we were not only looking at the best project plan, we were also looking at, we wanted to see that cycle. Is there a scope to make changes as they grow? In project management term, they call it agile practices, ability to change things as you go ahead. And this is again quite a hot topic, and co-design is the other thing. You might like to Google that, because that is also quite popular. Last, and but not the least, look, you cannot be in the firefighting mode all the time, right? No matter how much you can manage stress, and no matter how good you are in doing things, that will drag you down. You will get, you know, it's like a war, you know, it's not a battle that you have to fight. Being a health professional in the new landscape is about fighting a constant war. So I would encourage you to have fun in life, give yourself a pat, and celebrate even small things in life. And this is my family, my little one, and the elder one is at the back. So that is very, very important. And that is something we underestimate, because if you're not able to take care of yourself, you're not going to be able to cope with this war. And don't sweat on small stuff. You know, I remember in my university days, we used to get asked questions like, so which is better? So what is muscle tone, and what is spasticity? What is the difference? So you talk about Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Does the nerve get affected first, or does the vein get affected first, or the blah, blah. So don't worry about these things. If you don't get it right as a student, don't worry about that. There's a lot more to learn. Think about how you are going to position yourself in a wider landscape when you're out. And here, I'll give my example. I had failed my final year, and I don't have any hesitation to accept that. And I fail in psychiatry. And now I lead one of the programs, which is nationally, which is related to psychiatry. So keep doing your hard work, and just make yourself proud, your family proud, and of course, your nation proud. Thank you very much, and namaskar. That's all.
Dr. Harsh, you are bang on time. I don't see any question answers here yet. In case there are, all the audience, please put in your questions. In case not, we can proceed for the paper presentations, and you can get connect to Dr. Harsh personally. I see no questions. So should we then begin with the scientific session for the paper presentations?
First, let me thank Dr. Harshvardhan for his fantastic whatever the speech he gave, and his experience from his occupational therapy as a student days till now. And I really love that last part, have fun. That's most important in the life. And even though how much stress you can bear it, but you have to pat yourself. Thank you so much for giving us such good suggestions. Thanks a lot. So I'll be very happy to invite all the presenters. First, let me congratulate all of you that you have been selected. That means your presentations are good. And all the best, all of you. And I know you, my children, they will do good. So first speaker is Dr. Pooja Mehta. Preferences and practices of therapeutic interventions by occupational therapists. A survey of Indian versus global standards. And I hope all of you know that you have been given 10 minutes and the timer will be on. If you want, I don't mind reminding you, but please keep a watch on the timer. Start, please. Thank you.
Good afternoon, one and all. I'm presenting paper titled Occupational Therapy Intervention Survey Study, Part 1, that's Preferences and Practices of Therapeutic Intervention by Occupational Therapists, an online survey of Indian versus global standards. Occupational therapy is an evolving profession with emerging new modalities. Purposeful and meaningful activities are core domain of occupational therapy. Various studies on OT practices, OT interventions in different countries and therapy settings are being done, but none published on Indian population, none comparing the standards of practice across the globe. Hence, we would want to know, are occupational therapists in India and globally practicing the global core domains, justifying the professional practices? If yes, then to what extent? And if no, then why not? Hence, we aim to study, to analyze differences, if any, in the OT practices and preferences of therapeutic intervention by Indian versus global standards. We used online survey-based observational cross-section study design, adhered to the principles of declaration of Helsinki, and took prior electronic written informed consent. We used a snowball method of sampling during the duration of May 2020 to November 2020. Please note that this paper reports interim analysis and the participation link is still open and data collection is ongoing. We received 178 responses by November 2020, of which 162 fulfilled the selection criteria of at least bachelor's occupational therapy degree from recognized university, currently practicing as OTIST in any setting with minimum 3 years of experience. And we excluded occupational therapists involved exclusively in teaching and on managerial roles. Post sampling, we made two groups, Indian and global, each had 81 sample sites. Assessment tool is self-explanatory and self-administered questionnaire. It's designed by three authors and content validity is performed by two expert occupational therapists and three authors. Questionnaire included demographics, professional profile, 17 areas of clinical practice, types of intervention along with their examples and its frequency of use. Factors influencing OT practice, it's a phase two of the study. Time required for the completion of the study of the questionnaire was 45 to 60 minutes. This was the questionnaire. Descriptive and inferential data analysis was done using SPSS software. This graph shows the number of responses of Indian occupational therapists across 11 states of India, while this graph shows number of responses of global occupational therapists across 17 countries. Graph 1 shows mean age and work experience of global occupational therapists, which is more than that of Indian occupational therapists. Graph 2 shows significant difference in gender distribution between the groups. Graph 3 shows significantly more of Indian occupational therapists with master's degree, while the global group has significantly more occupational therapists with additional qualifications. Graph 4 shows significantly more Indian occupational therapists practicing in private clinic, private hospitals, while significantly more global occupational therapists practice in other areas, that is nursing facilities, community-based rehabs, etc. Graph 5, it showed among various organization roles, significant difference was seen among consultants or teaching faculty and exclusively practicing only in one role between the two groups. Graph 6, it shows various age groups of which significant differences were seen in the practice of all age groups and exclusively in one age group, adult, geriatric, and neonatal age group. While graph 7, it shows among various areas of clinical practice, significant more Indians work in developmental disabilities, mental health, neonatal care, antenatal and postnatal women's care, obesity and weight management, and hemophilic care, all of which were more practiced by Indian occupational therapists. Graphs 8, it shows different type of interventional units, where significantly more Indians worked in OPD settings of clinic and hospitals, hospital IPD settings, while global occupational therapists work more significantly in natural environments. Graph 9, it shows among different types of interventions that are frequently used, significantly more Indians used performance skills training than global occupational therapists. Occupational therapy started in the government sector, but less than 25% of Indian occupational therapists currently work there. This could probably be due to job availability and pay scale differences between the two sectors. And this has also led to the growth and diversification in private sector in India, as evident by 57% practicing in private clinics and 36% in private hospitals. Dominance of the private practice has led to following results, as private clinic provides freedom to practice in age group of choice and areas of interest and specialization. 44% practice as consultants, 88% practice in developmental disabilities rehabilitation, and 72% work in OPD setting environment. OT practice was also found to have influenced by the country's healthcare model. In India, it is influenced by the medical model with emphasis on symptom recovery, and this has led to more work done in hospital and clinic settings, using performance skill training as most used intervention type, as environment influences the type of intervention used. While globally, it's influenced by social disability model, emphasizing on functional recovery, and hence occupational therapists were found to work more in natural settings, home-based and communities, with use of activities as therapeutic media as the most common type of practice. It was also found to have been influenced by the type of reimbursement. In India, we have client-paid practice, while in global, it's insurance covered. So in India, it was seen that major practice was in private sector with diversification in areas of practice, and it enabled client-centered practice across all phases of diagnosis and rehab process, and it facilitated use of all types of intervention in conjunction. However, in globally, it was seen that major practice was in government sector, and it limited the area of practice, especially for preventive healthcare areas, as insurance guidelines have clear demarcation of OT practice regarding diagnostic and rehab phase in which the OTIST can intervene and be reimbursed for. This limits the use of types of intervention in conjunction. Occupational therapy practice, to some extent, is also influenced by socio-cultural differences. In India, we have joint family culture. As a result, there is a codependence, limiting practice in geriatric and adult age group, while in Western countries, emphasis or need for independence is high. 57% of global occupational therapists practice in geriatric age group. Also, the average life expectancy in global countries is higher than in India. Differences in these OT practices could thus be due to dominance in healthcare sector, healthcare model practice by the country, socio-cultural differences, visibility to therapy settings, and reimbursement type. Implications of the study. Globally, healthcare policies are reorienting to a promotion of optimal health, but both groups minimally use preventive intervention and health promotion and advocacy. Thus, health promotion and advocacy content should gain coverage in the OT curriculum with emphasis on hands-on practice. Very few Indians were found to work as mentors, but mentors impart implicit knowledge of the art of the profession, which is not found in the textbooks, and thus it helps develop profession's identity. Hence, the mentorship culture of each one teach one needs to be cultivated in the OT practice in India. This study thus provides a current scope and areas for diversification to reposition OT practice in India, to diversify that OT practice in India, and to be at par with the Indian government's vision 2030, that Swasth Bharat. Occupational therapists should proactively advocate themselves as health promoters, conduct programs and camps for health promotion lifestyle redesign, surveillance and response camps to identify at-risk individuals and provide early intervention, and engage more in community-based intervention. Limitations of my study were, snowball sampling method could lead to over or under representation. Time for completion of the questionnaire was more, limiting responses. Sample size was small. Generalization of results need to be done with caution. Questionnaire was only in English. As a result, no responses from South American or European countries was found. Suggestions for future research, detailed research in various domains and areas of practice. Experimental study could be done on medical model versus social disability model in OT practices. Conclusion. So the OT practice in India is comparative to the global standards of care as defined by professional guidelines. However, these are the subtle differences. Indian occupational therapists work more in private sector as consultants, treat majorly children, majorly in the area of developmental disabilities, in OPD settings, and mostly use consultation and performance skill training. While global occupational therapists majorly work in government sector as supervisors, treat children and geriatric patients equally, majorly in the area of developmental disabilities, in national settings, and most used is interview and activities as therapeutic media. These differences are attributed to differences in healthcare system, medical model, reimbursement policies, and therapy setting. These are my references. Acknowledgement, would like to especially thank our president, Dr. Anil Keshavaswa, for approving providing contact details of the members of AOTA to participate in the study, and also like to acknowledge our two experts, Dr. Shobha Nair and Dr. Shashidhar sir, for our expert validation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to tell all the delegates and viewers that along with me, even Dr. Harshvardhan is chairing this session. So I'm my apologies, Dr. Harshvardhan, that I did not inform all the delegates and the presenters and all. So if we will see any questions. So Dr. Harshvardhan, you can see in the question box and you can ask. There are three questions. Yeah, there are three questions in the question answer box. Shall I go through it?
Yes, please. I'm still figuring out how.
Respected chairperson, yes. Restrict to two questions only.
Yeah. So we'll ask only two questions. First question is how different fields of practice were taken care of? What was your gold standard and procedure followed to establish preferences in relation to clinical reasoning?
So basically, a very detailed questionnaire was formed, as you could have seen. There were 17 areas of clinical practice which were covered, and multiple choice questions were taken care of. And expert validation was also done. And this included by going through very exhaustive literature review from multiple books to collect all those 17 areas of practice, which are possibly being practiced by occupational therapists across the globe. So there is possible that some areas may not have been covered, but we tried our best to be as exhaustive as possible. And as a result, you could have seen the questionnaire went to 45 minutes. It had become exhaustive, but we had to do it in order to cover all the practices across the globe. So, Good.
Yeah,
so we did our best.
Yeah, thank you. Now the second question is data disaggregated for India is available as rural versus urban? Any finding in this on OT in India? I also wanted to ask you the same question. Good.
Yes, so basically there was no disaggregation of data done for rural versus urban. Because it was taken collectively for entire India, as well as for the abroad. But considering this could be done as a further step in the study, but this scope was limited for the current phase. See, it's a phase one of our study, and we are planning the second phase, in which we would take up the factors that would influence the OT practice. So the current scope study didn't allow us to disaggregate the data into rural and urban, but we would do it definitely.
Please. Yeah. I'm sorry, I cannot ask more than two questions. The third question, I think the person can contact. Yes, please. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Dr. Harshvardhan, will you call the second presenter?
Yes, please. Yeah. So the second presenter is Dr. Suresh Kumar K. And his topic is a systematic review of the evidence for occupational therapy in India. So Dr. Suresh, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Harsh. First of all, a warm greetings to all of you and respected chair and panel members, as well as my OT colleagues and friends from all over India. we would like to actually present as a team, and I'm actually representing as an author for a group of OTs who have done this particular work. This is on a systematic review for looking at evidence for occupational therapy to reduce disabilities in India exclusively. We have registered this particular review with Prospero, and you can look at our protocol in the York database. I'm sorry about the, yes. Okay, so moving on to the burden of diseases. So I just wanted to reiterate what happened and what is happening in India in terms of the burden of diseases in our own country. So the past 20 years, we have been believing that most of the disability is created by infectious diseases. However, in the past 10 years, we have moved beyond that particular assumption, and we experience disability currently due to most of the non-communicable diseases and injuries. So we have lots of years lived with disability and years of lives lost because of disability in our country, rather than just looking at deaths that happens every year. So this is the estimate that came from the burden of disease study 2 years back. Sorry, I'm not sure. Yeah. So when you look at the exclusive burden of disability in India, I'm really sorry about the blood in between. I'm not sure why it's coming.
Yeah, just ignore it. I think just carry on. Should be
just okay. Carry on.
So when you look at burden of disability in India, what we believe is whatever I've just presented, it's only 3% of the country's overall disability prevalence. We are not looking at what the world believes, which is about 15% of the whole world population are struggling from some kind of disability. So we are at least 500 times below what is globally accepted as the prevalence of disability. When you look at expenditure on health, yes, we have disability in the country, but how the country spends for disability in India, you can obviously see that this is the slide talking about the health expenditure per person by the government. And you can see comparing lots of lower and middle income countries, India ranks at the bottom spending $75. And within the $75, 70% of the $75 is coming from the private sector. And only 30% of this $75 is coming from the government. And in most instances, somebody who's experiencing disability in India are actually spending money from their pocket to make sure that they are empowered in the community and they are leading an independent social life. What happens when we look at our own profession in the country? It's been a significant journey for us since 1950. Till date, and we have lots of achievements in practice, we have lots of achievement in education, there are many colleges that have come up, we have also lots of professional development, we are now talking about an independent council at the state level and at the national level. However, when it comes to research, we have not achieved significantly. There is research that's happening in the country in relation to occupational therapy. However, compared to practice education and the professional dimensions which gets attention, research doesn't get that much attention. Hence, we wanted to actually have that as a rationale to go forward with this particular systematic review. So we know that persons with disability in India have poor access to occupational therapists and occupational therapy interventions. And the current evidence are usually replicated or implemented significantly from high-income countries. So we use evidence from New Zealand, Australia, and America, or UK to an Indian context, which may or may not work. So we did not know that. Therefore, we did a systematic review looking at existing evidence for occupational therapy to reduce disabilities in an Indian context. This is the objective of the study. So we wanted to evaluate the effectiveness of occupational therapy interventions for reducing disabilities in persons with disability in India compared to standard practice. we use the Cochrane methods. I am trained in Cochrane methodology before, and I'm an active Cochrane author. So we used 7 databases for electronic searching. We did hand search in specific journals where OTs can publish papers related to this particular topic. In IJOT, Indian Journal of Physio and Occupational Therapy as well, we also searched WFOT Bulletin. We also did a gray literature search looking at specific OT databases such as OT Seekers, documents related to this particular topic on APOTRG and clinical trial directories. The selection criteria is very clear. We only included randomized controlled trials for this particular systematic review, where the participants are persons with disability. Interventions that is provided would be occupational therapy interventions. Comparison is standard, and outcomes, we chose any outcomes related to disability in general, and looking at disability from the concept of International Classification of Functioning Disability and Health. The search was restricted for the past 20 years, and it was only published articles we took for this particular review. Data collection and analysis, all the authors were involved in electronic hand and gray literature search. I've just mentioned who all were there or how many were there. So 3 authors contributed to independent screening, 2 authors for independent data extraction, and 2 authors contributed to assessing methodological quality. Results, this is Prisma for the systematic review that we came up with. So we identified 3,228 articles from electronic databases and about 81 articles through our hand and gray literature search. So after removing duplicates, we had 2,668 studies to be screened, and we excluded 2,583. We had 85 studies for full text assessment, and after full text assessment for eligibility, we included 7 clinical trials that spoke about occupational therapy interventions for reducing disabilities in India. So these are the results. 7 RCTs of occupational therapy interventions for persons with disability in India, with about 305 participants in total with all those 7 studies. All 7 studies were very different in terms of its objective, participants, interventions, and outcomes. And hence, there was too much of heterogeneity among the studies that were included in this particular review. Allocation concealment and blinding risk of bias exclusively were high in 5 trials. All the trials reported impairment outcomes. This is something that I would like to reiterate. All the trials reported only impairment outcomes with statistically significant difference between the experimental group and the control group. So all the studies showed it is good. The intervention worked. However, the outcomes were related to impairments. This is the table showing the snapshot of all the studies. I just wanted to show this to you all for the heterogeneity aspect of it. So we had 3 studies from New Delhi. We had 2 studies from Mumbai, 1 from Chhattisgarh and 1 from Gujarat. The study from Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, from Gadse and Ganjiwala, and also Arya are some of the 3 studies which used about 50 to 60 participants in their study. So 3 big trials we had within those particular studies that we included for the study. The age groups were so different. We had people from more than 60 to 28 to 32 weeks of gestation as the whole range of people who have studied in this particular review. Interventions, as you can see, it's all different. Task-based mirror therapy, constraint-induced movement therapy, premature oromotor intervention, myofascial taping, biofeedback, gaming, and also looking at different kinds of special techniques predominantly, not OT-specific. Outcome measurements, there are functional assessments that's used by some of the authors or some of the papers in this particular review. However, the primary outcome is not function. The primary outcome is something related to, say, Brunstone recovery stage, Fugle-Mayer assessment, visual analog scale, depression anxiety scale, and grip strength, things like that. Because it was too heterogeneous, we did not do a meta-analysis, which will not give us correct answers anyway. I just wanted to also share the risk of bias that was involved. You can obviously see there was bias with red dots in allocation concealment, blinding of participants, and blinding of outcome assessments in most of the studies. And this is the grouping together of all the studies. You can see the amount of issues related to coming up with clear, good appropriate and unbiased answers. So you, with allocation concealment bias, blinding bias, it's absolutely not really possible for us to say that the intervention is really effective. There are biases and the review, that is why.
Have only 5 seconds. Yeah.
In plain language summary, we in the past 20 years, we have done on research for only 305 patients. None of the RCTs looked at functional independence, and we also like to focus on impairments rather than occupational therapy interventions. 7 trials included only unadulterated occupational. There was no trial that included unadulterated occupational therapy intervention. So trials have to be done with nationally standardized occupational therapy outcome measures. And this review actually confirms paucity of evidence for occupation-focused occupational therapy for persons with disabilities. I would like to reiterate that building capacity for rigorous and relevant scientific research in occupational therapy would be the possible strategy to bridge gaps in evidence for occupational therapy in India. And I would like to acknowledge my organizations that supported this particular review work. And I would like to finally say that evidence for occupational therapy matters to us in India, and we need to focus on that collaboratively and comprehensively. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Suresh. There are questions for you. Is data, this is last time's. Are the new ones?
I think last one is the new. What is the criteria of selection?
Yeah, can you read out, please?
So this question for you, Dr. Suresh, is what is the criteria for selection of quality of studies?
It's straightforward. We use the Cochrane risk of bias criteria for selection, looking at concealment, selection bias, performance bias, attrition bias, reporting bias, and other biases. So we looked back at the Cochrane handbook for looking at risk of bias assessment. Thank you, Dr. Harsh, and thank you, ma'am, for allowing me to talk after 5 seconds as well. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you. Now we call upon the next presenter, Dr. Pooja Vajarkar. She is going to speak on understanding of spirituality and its use as a domain of practice amongst occupational therapists in India. It is a qualitative study. Welcome, Pooja. Again, my student, and all the best. Start.
Good afternoon, Dr. Pooja here. First, I would like to congratulate you all for such a wonderful virtual conference. And my research topic title, Exploring Spirituality and Its Use as a Domain of a Practice Amongst Indian Occupational Therapists, a Qualitative Study. Background, occupational therapists have shown considerable interest in spirituality as a domain of practice. Spirituality and coping strategies. OTIS are associated with the holistic and person-centered approach to care in order to restore a sense of well-being and recognize the individual. However, ambiguity and diverse practice notions have an impact on the use of spirituality in day-to-day life. Another challenge was spirituality has not been given much importance due to lack of clear definition of spirituality and the unclear relationship between religion and spirituality. The recent study indicated that there is limited research in the area of spirituality in occupational therapy groups and educational programs in South African context and other Western context. Likewise, there is scarcity of research on the occupational therapy perspective on understanding and concerning spirituality in occupational therapy practice in India. Purpose of the study, to bridge the gap by exploring spirituality as domain of practice in occupational therapists amongst Indian occupational therapy. Objective of the study, to explore and understanding spirituality and its use as a domain of practice in Indian occupational therapists. Research design, it is a qualitative narrative study. Study setting was in India, and 15 participants from private and public sector were selected. Those who are having 10 years of experience. Ethical approval has been taken. This is the demographic information of my sample. Inclusion criteria was bachelor in occupational therapy with minimum 10 years of experience, Indian occupational therapist practicing actively in India, informed consent. Exclusion criteria was no informed consent, resident outside India and age less than 30 years. The equipment was semi-structured qualitative guide, which was being used for senior occupational therapists to explore knowledge and understanding of spirituality as a domain of practice. we have taken these themes considering this this research and this literature. Then data collection and analysis, in-depth interviews were taken, and then expanded notations and transcribed, those were transcribed into English. Coding of the interviews were done manually on the Excel sheet, and then initial coding tree were developed, and on the basis of that, the themes were generated, and those themes I'll be discussing it in my results. Results. This study describes occupational therapists' understanding of spirituality, their understanding of spirituality and religion, and finally, their knowledge of spirituality as domain of practice in occupational therapy in Indian context. So the themes are understanding of spirituality, differentiating spirituality from religion, spirituality as a domain of practice in occupational therapy. These are my themes and the description and codes which are related to the themes. Results, understanding of spirituality. As reported by all the participants, spirituality has been understood considering either secular as well as theological or religious concepts. As said by one of the participants, spirituality is a guiding source, higher self, sense of power, which is a higher power beyond our power, which can affect the outcome of our effort. And I also believe in that destiny is affected by guiding source. Many participants use religious terminology, which provided them with the clearest way to explain their ideas in depth. Most of the participants noted that, that they felt each individual spirituality was unique and did not necessarily include religious content. One of the participants mentioned, I consider the religion of the person. I respect the religious practices of the person. For me, ritual may not really mean anything. However, I would understand and act accordingly. Differences in understanding the meaning of spirituality. Spirituality and religion are increasingly recognized as influencing people's health and rehabilitation. In OT, spirituality is recognized as important in influencing occupational performance, yet methods of integrating this performance component into daily practice remain elusive. As mentioned, I believe it is a different than religion. As we know, religion is something which is more likely practiced, followed by the community or a group of people. And spirituality is more individual. It's up to you what makes you feel connected with superpower or a higher power. One therapist informed that he is not sure about his belief on spirituality or a religion. I have never given so much thought to spirituality or whatever. But yes, you are yourself. And you also have to realize that there is something I believe in and I don't know if it is spiritual or religion. However, some of the therapists who were secular while defining spirituality may result in clear differentiation between religiosity and spirituality. These therapists consider the patient's spiritual needs enacted through developing effective therapeutic relationship that was not necessarily linked to meeting religious needs. As mentioned, I consider the hobbies of the patient wherein they forget themselves and feel peaceful. According to me, process is more important than the end product in practicing spirituality. Spirituality as a domain of a practice in occupational therapy. When we asked therapists whether they use spirituality as a domain of practice, they responded that either they brought it up directly or indirectly, while few therapists informed that they were never brought up spirituality in their practice due to various reasons. Other therapists reported that they brought spirituality up directly or indirectly by permitting the client, by raising spiritual issues, creating an environment that was conducive to spiritual discussions. Few therapists reported that how they are assessing spiritual domain into their practice and related challenges. As mentioned, at present, we are not using any formal assessment tool and also not aware of any assessment tool which assesses the spirituality aspect of a person. We use COPM, that is Canadian Occupational Therapy Performance Measure, which has some components on spirituality. She also said that what she uses is more of a quality of life assessment. While we spoke about importance of meditation, time of reflection, and daily personal rituals, the therapeutic use of self, playfulness as a medium of intervention in their routine occupational therapy practice. As mentioned, we use meditation, yoga relaxation techniques, which are helpful in mental health conditions. We need to consider the hobbies of the patients wherein they forget themselves and feel peaceful. We also found that few therapists never brought up spirituality due to various reasons as follows. OTs do not know how to talk about it, do not have language for it other than religious language and are not comfortable with that. OTs do not know enough about other faiths beside their own to feel comfortable talking to people about spirituality. They feel that spirituality is too personal to talk to the client about. OTs feel that the therapeutic milieu is not appropriate for discussions of this kind. Otis feel that their therapeutic relationships are not sufficiently long duration to build the trust necessary for these discussions. One therapist cautiously reported that, yes, definitely that is needed, but I didn't make any effort to use spirituality in my practice. We don't provide direct intervention for spirituality, so that should not be a domain of a practice. Few of the respondents were confused, undecided, or disagreed that spirituality hold a viable position in scope of occupational therapy practice, even though majority agreed that spirituality was an important part of the daily job responsibilities. One therapist interestingly shared that little is known about spiritual practices among practicing therapists and need to include in academic program. As mentioned by one of the participants, occupational therapist has to guide patient in spirituality, that if we therapists do not know what it is, then how can we guide them? We have to include spirituality at the undergraduate level itself as a part of a curriculum, and we have to conduct professional development program. Discussion, limited understanding of spirituality among Indian occupational therapists with the understanding lacking clarity. Despite a range of definitions of spirituality offered for a healthcare practice, there are concerns about understanding a concept so individual and deeply personal, which is influenced by an individual's belief, culture, and worldviews. While none of the participants seems to be completely at ease offering an understanding of spirituality, together their ideas formed some understanding about spirituality as a domain of practice. As per all the participants, spirituality has been defined considering both secular as well as theological concept. The majority of the therapists found difficulty in differentiating spirituality from the religion. However, therapists use spirituality as a domain of practice in OT in India. We found that some therapists brought it up directly. Other therapists reported that they brought spirituality by indirectly by permitting client to raise spiritual issues, creating an environment that was conducive to spiritual discussions. Furthermore, there are circumstances when no one discusses about spirituality. Little is known about spiritual practices that sustain and inform among occupational therapy practice. Some interviews reported drawing on their religious faith to orient ground and give meaning to their work, while some of them spoke about meditation, time of reflection, daily personal rituals, yoga, Reiki, meditation. With regard to assessment and intervention, few of the respondents were unsure about devoting or did not wish to devote any more attention in terms of formal evaluation and treatment to issues of spirituality.
You have 25 seconds.
Yes, ma'am. Finding of this limitation of the study, finding of the study may not give in-depth information to occupational therapy practice in India. Of a group of participating occupational therapists may not be representative of general population. This indicates a need for further research to be conducted with more occupational therapists or by conducting focus group discussion to enhance body of knowledge related to spirituality. Implication of the study, the current interest in how and whether spirituality should be considered within OT highlights the need for an understanding of how therapists are presently incorporating spirituality into practice. Many respondents in the present study wish to devote more attention to spiritual function of a practice, and the majority agree that current academic training is not enough to prepare to deal with the client's spiritual issues. Therefore, it is prudent to include topic of understanding of spirituality and its clinical implication in occupational therapy practice, current OT curricula, to help practitioner to be more prepared to address and respond to client's spiritual needs. The conclusion is there is a complexity in understanding this topic. There is limited understanding, and this study has given insight into how occupational therapists use spirituality as domain of practice. The future path is it is utmost a need to develop guidelines on practicing spirituality in occupational therapy practice by generating further discussion and evidence on the subject. These all are my references and acknowledgement. Thank you, ma'am, for giving me extra time.
Thank you, Pooja. But I can see one question now at present. There is literature on clarity, on definition, as it is individualistic orientation and self-concept. Would be happy to share and contribute in this domain. That's it.
So oh, thank you.
It is good. It's just a suggestion and advice.
Ma'am, any question from your side?
Yeah, Dr. Harshvardhan, I would be happy if you ask her.
No, I do not have any question as such, but yeah. I'll summarize it at the end. I've got a few points for you, Dr. Pooja, and I'll discuss that at the end.
Pooja, I have one question, or you can say whatever. Yes, spirituality is important, but sometimes I feel this also came in my mind, and that is a question to you. They always feel that this is their personal thing. They don't want to, this is what you have done it. I'm very happy that you have done all this survey and all that. So have you come across any type of patients who don't want to discuss with you? Can you do that? And then that is very important aspect.
Ma'am, there are people who in fact doesn't want to discuss it.
So in that case, what will you do?
Ma'am, there are different kinds of medium and maybe different kinds of activities or their interests, which itself suggests that how you can brought their spirituality up. Secondly, we all are spiritual beings. So whatever we do it in that way only. So we can't segregate spirituality from any part of us.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, now we, Dr. Harshvardhan, can you call the next person, please?
Yes, so the next person is Dr. Aishwarya Swaminathan, and the topic is effectiveness of occupational therapy interventions in children and youth in India, meta-analysis. So over to you, Dr. Aishwarya.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. My today's topic is effectiveness of occupational therapy interventions in children and youth in India, a meta-analysis. Introduction. Meta-analysis is a quantitative study design used to systematically assess previous research studies to derive conclusions about that body of research. This approach of integrating and interpreting a body of treatment effectiveness research arose in the mid-1970s and has become much prevalent recently. Occupational therapy interventions in children and youth is one of the most practiced areas in occupational therapy, and synthesis of research can give better insights about its effectiveness. A meta-analysis of occupational therapy effectiveness studies in children and youth in India has not yet been carried out. So the aim of this study is to estimate the effectiveness of occupational therapy interventions in children and youth in India. Methods. A literature search was conducted for the original articles published between 2001 and 2020 from PubMed, ResearchGate, Google Scholar, All India Occupational Therapy Association website, Indian Journal of Occupational Therapy website, and Indian Journal of Physiotherapy and Occupational Therapy website. So the inclusion criteria were the articles that were specifically effect or effectiveness studies of occupational therapy interventions in children and youth in the age range of 3 to 21 years. Both one group pre-post designs and two group designs, including quasi-experimental and RCTs, were selected. 47 articles were selected, which showed a variety of treatment interventions in diverse populations. So overall, there were three RCTs and three studies that were pertinent to youth. The OT intervention areas that were covered in these studies were motor, sensory, cognitive, perceptual, psychosocial, ADL, work, school or vocational, and play and leisure. So all the OT interventions that were included in these studies are shown on the screen. So there were plenty, and all these the brackets show the number of studies in which these techniques have been used. So overall, the studies were either one group study in which one or two OT techniques were used, or it was a two group study where one technique was compared to another technique, or it was a study where in one group, one particular technique plus occupational therapy, conventional occupational therapy was used and compared to only conventional occupational therapy. So overall, the results were that either one technique was seen to be significantly better than the other, or both the techniques were equal in their effectiveness, or it was one technique plus OT was more effective than only conventional OT. So the population that was seen in all these studies were cerebral palsy, autism, ADHD, learning disability, intellectual disability, Down syndrome, obesity, and even typical children and youth were involved. For example, like if they had handwriting issues and so on. So for all these studies, the effect size calculation was done. So amongst these studies, six studies, they had themselves mentioned the effect sizes in their published articles. For remaining articles, the effect size calculation was done by the authors. And effect size is an absolute difference between the means of the two groups. To make it standardized, it is divided by the pooled standardized deviation. And for other articles, even the T values or the Z values and F values of various statistical analytical tests that were used were also used for the effect size calculations along with the means and the standard deviations. So after each article, effect size was calculated for each article. Some adjustments were done for overcoming the sample size bias, which was small, and also to overcome the measurement unreliability. So this was done by using various formulas, which included the sample size estimation, as well as the correlation coefficient for the scales or the measurements that were used. So overall, the effect sizes were calculated by using the Revman software from Cochrane, and it was of the version 5.4.1. And this is the effect size classification given by Jacob Cohen, in which he mentions that a small effect size is that of 0.2, medium is that of 0.5, and large effect size are that of 0.8 and above. He also mentioned about the percentile as well as the non-overlap percentages between the two groups that are being compared. So based on this, out of the 47 effect sizes that were calculated, 12 outliers were found, which were inflated effect sizes more than 2. And therefore, these were excluded from the analysis. And the final study included were 35 studies. And the number of participants in all the studies put together was 957. Results and discussion. For these studies, a homogeneity test was conducted and the Cochrane's Q value was found to be 6.92, which was less than the chi-square table value, indicating that the data was homogeneous. And this is a forest plot, which is indicating the effect sizes for the two group studies, which were 20 in number. It also indicates the 95% confidence interval for all these effect sizes. This is similarly the forest plot for one group studies, which were 15 in number, showing the effect sizes and the 95% confidence interval for the same. So the Cohen's D value, which is the standardized mean difference or the effect sizes for all these studies. So for two group studies, it was seen that 15% of the studies showed small effect size, 55% showed medium effect size, 35% showed large effect size. And for one group studies, 46.66% showed medium effect size, 53.33% showed a large effect size. And if we see area-wise, all the areas showed medium effect sizes except for sensory and psychosocial, which showed large effect sizes. Rest all showed medium effect sizes. So for all these studies, an overall mean effect size was calculated. In general, when we publish studies, we mention about the significance value, which gives us whether the change in the two groups is by chance or whether it occurred because of the intervention that was provided. Whereas effect size, it tells us about the magnitude of this difference, which is more important. And therefore, p-value is not enough. Even the effect size needs to be reported. So in this study, overall, the weighted mean effect size was seen to be 0.66 with a medium effect size. And the standard error, confidence interval, and the Z values were calculated, which was seen to be less than the table value, indicating that the null hypothesis that occupational therapy interventions are not effective in children and youth in India was rejected. And the alternate hypothesis that occupational therapy interventions in children and youth in India are effective. So the publication bias assessment was also done. So this was obtained by the value of fail-safe N, which revealed that 15 non-sampled studies averaging an effect size of 0 would be needed to exist to render the cumulative positive effect of this meta-analysis non-significant. Variations in the effect sizes that were calculated in this study. The range of effect sizes in this meta-analysis was 1.39, which suggests that the outcomes of differing occupational therapy services for children and youth are not uniform. Because an overall positive effect has been documented, further research needs to address specific types of OT interventions in special populations. So the future implications of this study are that the results are of practical importance because if this data is shared with occupational therapy clients or stakeholders like administrators, policymakers who influence the healthcare access for children and youth, it will be helpful. And the effect sizes, as already mentioned in the study, that only 6 articles had mentioned the effect sizes. They had reported these. So the implication is that effect sizes should be used throughout the process of the research studies from the planning phase also, that is for calculating the sample size itself. So this can be done by using pilot studies or literature review or using a projected effect size. And it has to be also analyzed and reported. Also, authors can provide descriptive statistics like means, standard deviations, the values which will be required for other authors to calculate the effect sizes in future, if required, not just in this area of children and youth, but also in other practice areas of occupational therapy, so that the effectiveness of occupational therapy, which is so well known in the clinical area, can be reinstated even in the research field.
15 seconds, please.
Yes. So these are my references.
Thank you.
And acknowledgements. Thank you.
What promoted you to do this study?
A minute. Have I stopped sharing the screen? I can't see. Yes. Okay. Overall, the knowing the effectiveness, we know that through clinical practice that yes, occupational therapy is effective. We practice in so many areas. It is like a varied techniques, etc., that we use. But to add some quantitative values to it and to make sure that yes, over last 20 years, occupational therapy has definitely been effective. So then I thought systematic review. Then I thought, okay, to make it even more quantitative, a meta-analysis can be done, you know, so that numbers also it can be, I just wanted to see that.
Okay, another question is, how did you categorize the effectiveness of OT intervention?
I didn't understand the question actually.
How did you categorize the effectiveness of OT intervention? You said those, I think this is what he wants to know, that yes, you said there's a particular OT intervention was effective. That was your end. You said that occupational therapy was effective. So how did you do that? How did you categorize it? How did you find it?
Because all these studies, most of them, if you see, they have already proved that a significant result in those studies. They have p-values in which the significance is already given. So here now we are all additionally calculating the effect sizes so that we know the magnitude of this significance. So this was done overall for all the areas together. That was the overall effect size as well as in those areas which I had mentioned in the study, that's motor, sensory, cognitive, and so on. Yes.
That's what they want to know. How did you categorize the effect? Thank you. Thank you so much, Aishwarya. Today, all my students are appearing and presenting it. I'm so happy. I'm so happy that this session has been given to me. And I'm very proud for all of you who are presenting it. Our next speaker is Perception of Psychiatrists on Occupational Therapy Practice in Mental Health, a Qualitative Study. Dr. Siddhi Kamath.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Perception of Psychiatrists on Occupational Therapy Practice in Mental Health, a Qualitative Study. Background. In India, there is a significant predominance among... how to shut this down?
Don't bother. Carry on, please.
Okay. Background. In India, there is a significant predominance of mental health illnesses among various age groups. This causes incapacitation in various domains of functioning. Also, a large majority of population face psychological issues hindering their emotional and psychosocial well-being due to the current lifestyle and working conditions. All these individuals require a comprehensive interdisciplinary intervention approach. Since the psychiatrists are the primary referral source for OT, it becomes increasingly important to know how psychiatrists perceive OT in mental health. Also, it is noted that there is limited knowledge present among OT among health professionals, and there is a dearth of research on what perceptions the psychiatrists hold about OT practice in mental health in the Indian as well as the Western context. Moreover, the existing studies have explored understanding of OT among health professionals in general or psychiatrists' knowledge about general OT. The purpose of my study was to understand psychiatrists' perception of OT practice in mental health, and the objective of the study was to interview the psychiatrists in depth and explore their understanding of occupational therapy practice in mental health. Methodology: the ethical clearance was obtained. The study employed a qualitative descriptive study design, and 10 psychiatric practitioners currently practicing in Goa were selected for the study. Methodology: sample selection. Inclusion criteria was qualification of MD psychiatry degree from a recognized institution currently practicing in Goa and work experience of 3 or more years in psychiatric practice. The exclusion criteria was other mental health professionals and practitioners of other specialty. Equipments: a semi-structured interview guide was developed by iterative process. The interview guide included questions which explored understanding of the stakeholders in mental health work settings and the beneficiaries of OTs in mental health, and their outlook on the role of OT in mental health. Data collection and analysis: an in-depth interview was conducted. Transcription of the audio files into detailed written documents and manual coding of the data was done into Excel sheets. Then there was generation of initial themes, understanding the perceptions of OT practice in mental health, and codes were explored for this study depict understanding the psychiatrist's perceptions of OT in mental health. The results: the following themes emerged from the study. Theme 1 was occupational therapist as an important stakeholder in mental health practice. Theme 2 was potential mental health settings and beneficiaries in the mental health practice. And theme 3 was OT interventions in mental health practice. Theme 1, occupational therapist as an important stakeholder in mental health practice. The participants were aware that OTs are important stakeholders in multidisciplinary health team, and OT is needed to address the occupational needs of the patient. All of the participants were of the opinion that OTs were significant stakeholders in the rehabilitation of the patients with mental health illnesses, along with psychiatrists and psychologists. Some of them expressed the view that having a multidisciplinary team allows multiple inputs regarding the patient's problems and allows for a treatment program which is more customized to meet the needs of the patient, and that OTs are required to address the occupational needs of the client. A participant said, "In this place where I would work earlier, the patient was seen by me, which is a psychiatrist, and then I would work with a team which had a nurse, an occupational therapist, a social worker, and the occupational therapist would be assigned to the patient for his vocational difficulties. And what happens is with such teams, you get multiple inputs, and it is a more customized approach tailored for the patient." Theme 2 was potential mental health settings and their beneficiaries. The study found that participants are aware that OTs can work in varied settings and deliver rehabilitation. They also mentioned those individuals who they thought would benefit from OT services. According to most of them, OTs can work in diverse settings such as tertiary hospitals, long-term care facilities, and de-addiction centers. Interestingly, a few participants also stated that OTs can work in prisons, child correction homes, corporate offices, and industries. A participant said, "It, that is OT, need not be restricted just to an inpatient setting in a big hospital. I know a really nice NGO where they have a really good OT setup, and they're all outpatient based." Another participant quoted, "If an occupational therapist is posted in jails, it would actually help the criminals and keep them continuously functioning." Most participants said that they would refer cases of psychosis, schizophrenia, bipolar affective disorder, depression, and substance abuse to OT. Few of them also highlighted that neurosis, personality disorder, Parkinson's disease, dementia, etc. will also benefit from OT. A participant said, "It is very useful in any case having mental health issues and wants to bounce back to normal, not just patients with schizophrenia or BPAD." Moreover, the participants also highlighted that there is scarcity of OTs practicing in mental health area, and more OTs should work in that field. A participant added, "The number of OTs practicing in India in mental health must be a few hundreds, even fewer in Goa. Sometimes we really want to refer a case to OT, but we do not know where to send them. More OTs should start working in this area." Occupational therapy practice. Intervention in mental health practice. The study found that participants were aware of OT interventions helped in promoting functional independence, social skills, socialization, and mental well-being. A participant said, "Most mentally ill patients feel that they are unwanted at home. You, that is OTs, teach them grooming, dressing, even brushing when they don't do it properly. This shows the patient that there is someone to takes interest in them and they are wanted. This sort of gives them a boost to do constructive activities." Most of the participants stated that OTs are involved in vocational and occupational rehabilitation. Few of the participants also emphasized that OTs are involved in skill training and leisure training. Although most participants displayed a fair understanding of the services and roles of OT in field of mental health, a few seem to have limited awareness on the scope of OT practice and certain misconceptions about the professional role. Such as a participant said, the ultimate aim of OT in acutely ill patients is distracting them from hallucinations and delusions. Furthermore, most of the participants, despite having named various activities such as gardening, woodwork, painting, tailoring, etc., which are used by OTs, admitted that they did not quite understand the clinical reasoning behind these treatment activities. A participant said, I had seen OTs work and I know that the activities aren't given just like that, but I did not know what exactly was happening. I'm not exactly aware of how you frame it out. Discussion. Firstly, the psychiatrist from the current study identified OT as a significant stakeholder in multidisciplinary team involved in mental health care and delivered services to various mental health facilities. OTs can work in a variety of settings with tertiary hospitals or mental health facilities, daycare centers and sheltered homes being the most agreed upon settings. However, they were of the opinion that although mental health OTs can practice in a wide range of clinical settings, they would benefit the most in somewhere where there is a multidisciplinary team setting. Second, the psychiatrist said that they would refer patients who are chronically incapacitated by long-standing mental disorders such as schizophrenia, depression, bipolar disorders, dementia and psychosis to OT and thought they would benefit from it. Few participants reported that the role of OT services from patients with neurosis and personality disorder. This shows that not all psychiatrists are fully aware that OT can benefit from patients suffering from neurosis, personality disorders, or individuals with some minor setbacks. Third, the psychiatrist identified OT as a healthcare profession concerned with functional and psychosocial rehabilitation of the patient people with mental health illnesses. That OTs majorly deal with vocational and occupational rehabilitation, and OTs work with individuals having mental health illnesses to reintegrate back them into their jobs. Promotion of functional independence and mental well-being of the beneficiaries, thus helping them reintegrate back into the community, was also identified as a role of OT. This shows that although the psychiatrists have a general idea of the role of OT in mental health and the professional goals, there seem to be a lack of clarity in relation to other stakeholders in the mental health practice. They also seem to display limited knowledge about treatment methods and approaches used by OTs in healthcare, mental health practice. Lastly, the psychiatrist said that the OT practice in mental health should not be restricted only to hospitals, but could be expanded to newer practice areas like managing stress in industries and among office employees and in prisons in correction homes. Implications of my study. The findings help to conceptualize awareness strategies that need to be developed for the psychiatrist in order to aid understanding of the role of OT in mental health rehabilitation. The number of OTs working in mental health is very low. Therefore, it is of utmost importance to encourage more OTs to practice in mental health area. Efforts should also be made to expand OT in practice at industries and corporate offices and in the area of forensic psychiatry. Some of the limitations of my study was time constraint since it was done during my internship period and the sample size was considerably small. Conclusion of the study, that OT interventions aid in improving functional and promoting mental well-being among individuals incapacitated by mental illnesses and psychological issues which hinder their adequate participation and engagement in life. Activities. The importance and the relative contribution of the OTs in multidisciplinary team is understood quite well, although some misconceptions about services and lack of clarity about roles and responsibilities of OT and other mental health care professionals in the mental health setting seem to exist among the psychiatrists. OT practice in mental health and psychosocial rehabilitation is understood by the psychiatrist to some extent, but efforts can be made to expand their insights about the OT services. However, and furthermore, developing clear guidelines for the OT practice in mental health and defining the occupational therapist's role in the psychiatric rehabilitation is the need of the hour. These are my references. Acknowledgement. I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to all the psychiatric practitioners for providing me with their time and cooperation. Dr. Pooja Vajratkar for her guidance and co-authoring this paper, to Dr. Vivek Vajratkar for his meticulous scrutiny on this study, to Dr. Teresa Ferreira, HOD of Neurology and Consultant Neurologist, and to Dr. S.M. Bandekar, Dean Medical Superintendent, HOD of Orthopedic Department, Goa Medical College. Thank you.
Wow. 000. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Any questions? I can't see any questions. No questions.
Ma'am, you would like to ask any or sir?
I will always ask, but I would be happy if Dr. Harshvardhan, do you have any question?
Yeah, I thought I'll ask one question.
Sure, good, good.
You know, of course, about your presentation, I'll summarize at the end, Sadisha, Dr. Sadisha, but my question is, if, say, I'm a policymaker, I can take decision to give funding to you to go and provide occupational therapy service in, say, in a prison, right?
Okay.
So how you would be convincing me that OT will help in prison based on your discussions with the people, you have had those discussions, how would you do that?
That OT is important in prisons. Yes. What happens is we often see that in prisons, they lose out on their routines and they all work like robots. So with a conversation in a psychiatrist, he said that they had this fixed time where they had to get up and then do certain activities, which were like cooking and stuff like that. But they were not really engaging in it. They were doing it for the sake of it. Also, people who are on death rows or people who are there forever, so they are not going to come out of the jail. What happens with them is the leisure is also lost. So it all... ultimately, without this leisure and without engagement in it, he said that there is a possibility that the aggression will build up or the self-esteem goes very low. So an occupational therapist, I think, will be able to aid there, especially among leisure and making a routine and scheduling them in such a way that they will also be engaging in these activities and not just doing it for the sake of it.
And what would be your ultimate goal? Like you have said, corrections, right? So when someone goes in prison, what is the ultimate goal for sending them to prison? Is that to punish them or to...
No, sir. I think mostly these crimes which are done are either as... they are done impulsively. So it's not that there is a permanent flaw in the person's person himself. So what we can do is make them better people. Probably by working out on their mental health issues, targeting what exactly is underlying in them, which is causing this sort of aggression or this sort of cruelty towards people or whatever. So, yeah, maybe addressing those issues. And most of them are also idle. So maybe if we could engage them permanently in some sort of vocation or get them somewhere in some sheltered employment or something like that. So... something like that would help them a lot. Or maybe have NGOs which is working out for them.
I agree. Yes. So thank you. And reintegrating them and preventing reoffense. So it's good. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. That's so much, sir.
Yeah. I just wanted to ask you, because you had given a lot of suggestion that more and more occupational therapists should work in mental health and all that. And we all are aware that maybe because of this reason, we are not being included in the bill, mental health bill. And it is such an important thing. And I'm very happy that you have presented this paper. But what will be your role? How will you prepare, make the awareness to all the psychiatrists or all the occupational therapists also to encourage them to work in? Can you just give me one or two suggestions? Because this is what we want to do it.
With regards to this research, what we can do is my sample size was small. So maybe we could interview more psychiatrists and then compare it with the scenario in other states so that we know where is the lacunae lying. So, and then we could address these awareness strategies exactly there. So what currently we are doing is we are saying there is awareness which is required, but we know that these psychiatrists, they very well know that we are there and we are helping people in functional rehabilitation, but they don't know how exactly we are going to do that. So maybe targeting awareness strategies which deal more in sensitizing them towards what frameworks we are using or how it works. Also, for encouraging occupational therapists, I think I had an excellent faculties, who developed this interest in psychiatry right from my undergraduate first year. So I think if people, that interest is put up in people's head when they're students itself, I think more people will be encouraged to work in this area.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Dr. Harshvardhan, now, can you call the last person, please?
Yeah, sure. So last but not the least important is Dr. Shilpshri P. Palsule, and sorry if I pronunciated incorrectly.
Correct.
And the topic is, does the informed consent document in allied health research follow the national guidelines retrospective study. So over to you, Dr. Silpshree. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody, respected chairperson, judges, and all the delegates. The topic for my presentation is, does the informed consent document in allied health research follow the national guidelines? This is a retrospective study. So an informed consent process is an important component of research. It is important to protect the participant autonomy. It is expected that the language of this informed consent document is simple so that the layperson understands. And it is the responsibility of the researcher to obtain consent from each and every participant of research. Also, it is the role of the ethics committee to scrutinize the consent document. Now, what is the requirement of this document? It is required to provide relevant information to the participants. It should ensure that the information is comprehended by them, and it should assure voluntariness of participation. As per ICMR 2017 guidelines, there are 10 essential components of the informed consent document. The first is that it should mention that it is research. The purpose and method should be in a simple language. It should include a statement on expected duration, frequency of contact, participation numbers. It should include a statement on benefits to the participant or community. Any foreseeable risks or discomfort should be mentioned. Confidentiality of record should be explained to the patient. There should be a statement on payment or reimbursement for participation. There should also be a statement of free treatment and compensation for any research-related injury. There should be a statement on freedom to participate or withdraw. And lastly, the identity and contact numbers of both the research team and the ethics committee should be included. Now, why this study? We all know that it is imperative that the ICMR 2017 guidelines are followed for biomedical health research. It is also important to ensure protection of patients' rights. On our literature search, we did not find studies evaluating the ethics of the informed consent process in allied health sciences. So we aim to conduct this study to find out whether the informed consent documents submitted by initial review by allied health branches of our tertiary care hospital follow the ICMR 2017 guidelines and whether they relate closely to the protocol submitted at the time of initial review. The inclusion criteria was the informed consent documents and protocols submitted by three allied health branches between the 1st November of 2018 and 31st October 2019, both observational and interventional studies were included, and submissions for expedited and full board review were included. The exclusion criteria was protocols which were submitted for exemption of review, any retrospective studies without any informed consent document, and other regular protocols who had not submitted the informed consent documents. So in this study period, we found 40 protocols, out of which one was exempt from review, and out of 39, four of them had not submitted the ICD, hence were excluded. So totally 35 protocols were reviewed. The Institutional Ethics Committee approval was obtained through expedited review. The informed consent documents of the protocols from November 2018 to October 2019 were reviewed. Each of these ICDs were analyzed to adherence to ICMR 2017 guidelines, and they were also compared with the protocols submitted. And flaws on part of the researcher and the ethics committee were noted. So as you see in this bar graphs, there were flaws noted on part of the researcher in each of the 10 compulsory statements for informed consent. We further decided to analyze whether these flaws were rightly picked up by the institutional ethics committee. So the first statement of research, out of the 35 protocols submitted, there was a flaw in one of them, and this was rightly pointed out by the IEC. Regarding the purpose and methods of research, there were flaws in 10 protocols out of 35 regarding purpose of research. These were rightly pointed out by the IEC only 50% of the times. Regarding methods, there were flaws in 4 out of the 35 protocols, again not pointed out by the Institutional Ethics Committee 50% of the times. all these times, the flaws were basically a technical language used for the purpose and methods of the study. Regarding expected duration of research, this duration was not mentioned in 16 protocols out of 35. Again, 50% of the times, the Institutional Ethics Committee did not point out this mistake. Sample size, which is again a compulsory inclusion, was not mentioned in 12 out of the 35 protocols. 50% of the times, the Institutional Ethics Committee failed to point out this mistake. In 10 protocols out of 35, in the benefits section, direct benefits were mentioned to the candidates regarding the research. 4 times out of 10, the Institutional Ethics Committee did not point out this mistake. Regarding risks and discomfort, most of these protocols were either minimal risk protocols or slight increase above minimal risk. However, 17 protocols did not mention the risk and discomforts improperly. 3 times out of this, the Institutional Ethics Committee did not point out this mistake. Confidentiality statement was there in all the 35 protocols with no flaws regarding the same. Reimbursement for participation was wrongly mentioned in 2 protocols out of 35, rightly pointed out by IEC both the times. Regarding treatment or compensation for research-related injury, this statement was not included in 5 out of the 35 protocols. 2 times out of this, IEC pointed out this mistake, 3 times it failed to. Freedom to participate or withdraw from research was not mentioned in 2 protocols out of 35, both the times the Institutional Ethics Committee rightly pointed out this mistake. Regarding what happens when the research trial stops, 5 protocols did not mention that, rightly pointed out by the Institutional Ethics Committee. The identity of the research team was not mentioned in 4 protocols out of 35. 1 time out of this, Institutional Ethics Committee did not point out this mistake. We further decided to analyze what could have been the possible reasons for these lapses. We realized that most of these protocols were PG theses done by students. So we found out that most of these students were probably unaware of the ICMR 2017 guidelines. Regarding lapses on the part of the Institutional Ethics Committee, we realized that the Institutional Ethics Committee caters to more than 400 proposals annually. Each of the Institutional Ethics Committee members have other work commitments in the hospital in addition to the Institutional Ethics Committee duty. Hence, probably there could have been some lapses while seeing the informed consent documents. It also happens that in the medical field, the researcher is not aware of non-medical terms. They do not understand that these are not easily comprehended by laypersons. Hence, probably they did not understand that the language was technical and not comprehended for a layperson. This study brought about the shortcomings on part of both the Institutional Ethics Committee and the researcher while preparing the informed consent document and scrutinizing it. On part of the Institutional Ethics Committee, it was failure to scrutinize the document well. On the part of the researcher, it was regarding failure to sincerely convey meaning and information. So we suggest that in cases of research for the students should also be well-versed in ICMR 2017 guidelines, and each of the ICDs should have a thorough review by the guide and the PG teacher. This study also lays an emphasis on the role of the layperson and the social scientist in the Institutional Ethics Committee. We also suggest a dictionary that is a ready reckoner of commonly used terminologies of the medical and allied health languages in simple language so that the researchers can use this. This study also came with its own limitations. We reviewed only the English language ICDs. Regional language ICDs were not included in this review. This would probably give out more issues. The layperson or the social scientist should have been involved to further analyze the ICDs from their perspective. Here are my references. Thank you.
Someone has asked you, need of informed consent is must as per the international guidelines. Then why this study was needed?
Yes. Thank you, madam. Basically, yes, the need. Is whether informed consent document is needed or no. Study was basically analyzed to see whether the informed consent documents that were submitted adhere to the national guidelines. Because most of the time what happens is the researchers do not pay attention to this aspect, which is a major ethical issue when you are conducting research. And hence the study was conducted.
Okay, this it's an interesting question. Does the author want to say that the ethics committee does not play its role properly? What is the implication for the OT practice?
This is a nice question, because we all think actually the ethics committees, we all know, in each of the hospitals are very unpopular, and they are said to harass the investigators and sort of discourage research by asking too many queries. But it also happens that the ethics committee probably has not paid that much attention to scrutinize this informed consent documents. As we all know that the clinicians and other scientific members of the committee have got a hold of responsibilities in tertiary care hospitals. And hence this study probably highlights the fact that we should not neglect the informed consent document along with the layperson.
Okay, raised questions, you please answer them separately in the question and answer box, please.
Sure.
Thank you so much, Shilpa.
Thank you, madam.
It was a nice presentation. Now, I would request Dr. Harshvardhan to summarize it, please.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Now, first of all, it has been an absolute pleasure to hear, listen to presentations from all of you. And I must say that this is my second conference I've attended with IOTA. The first one I attended I was an internship a long time back. And at that time, I was more interested in cultural program and seeing Hyderabad rather than attending the scientific presentations. And I'll be honest about it. But I have attended many other conferences. I have, you know, as president of the association, of course, I attended the Australian conference. But the quality, my wife is also an OT. And this, you know, tonight we were discussing about the quality of presentation which you guys are doing. It's absolutely marvelous. And I really congratulate you all. You know, and sometimes when I like things, it's difficult for me to ask too many questions because I get drawn by how people present. So all of you have done a great job. I did take, this time, you know, I'm not a student, so I was listening to everything and I've taken some notes, right, for you guys. First of all, Dr. Pooja Mehta, or Mehta, if there's no typo there, then I guess you talked about preferences and practices of therapeutic intervention by OTs, a survey of Indian and global standards. What I liked was you did mention that OT has evolved, and this is very important to remember. We started with art and craft activities and see where we are now. And you might have seen where we are with COVID-19, absolutely leading that group. So going forward, and I also like that you linked it with, you said it, health promotion. So basically you try to align with the strategy of the current government. And that is what I think every researcher should do. It's not just about, look, I'm a policymaker. I sit where policy decisions get made. And I see, you know, it's not just about research. It's also about when a research paper comes, they look at, is it aligning with the current government strategy? So if your research aligns with Modi ji's strategy of health promotion or well-being or yoga or whatever, then people are going to pay attention to that. I'm glad you pointed that out. You also pointed out about mentoring, and that is a gap I see in Indian context, that, and you know, people should be explicitly talking about the role of supervision and mentoring in practice. Sometimes when people apply for practicing certificates abroad, they will ask me, what does this mean, having a supervisor? Is that my boss? I said, no, it's not boss, it's clinical supervision. I think this is something which going forward needs to be encouraged in Indian context. Second one, Dr. Suresh, I really liked your the presentation style, very calm and comfortable, came up in a very a pleasant way, and I enjoyed listening to you. It's not that I did not enjoy others listening to, you know, but specifically I liked how you pointed out that most of the outcome measures were impairment based. It's very hard to show your contribution if you make impairment, if you rely on impairment based outcome measures. You know, I'll be, you know, you cannot show really that how much proprioception you have changed or vestibular processing you have changed, but you can show easily how self-care and ADLs, those things you have changed. So that is quite important, linking again to well-being. So that was quite good. And the next one was from Dr. Pooja Vajratkar. So I'm just looking at the notes I have got here. So you talked about spirituality, Dr. Pooja, and I really liked it. And I would like to share that this is something which is there in international space. World Federation of OT, they are trying their best to set up a group of occupational therapists to support indigenous population. And I see a huge role of the study you have got in that space. So Bijlani ma'am, if you can connect Dr. Pooja to those people, to that group, I think they will. Personally, I have always struggled to understand the difference between spirituality and religion.
And
you know, so I really enjoyed listening to you, and that was quite useful. And keep up the good work you have been doing. And you, at one place, you said worldview. It's very important to understand the worldview of our client. If we use our own lens to look at their problems, it's not going to work. We have to use their worldview and their lens. Going to Dr. Aishwarya Swaminathan, I'll just flick the paper to look at where the notes are. So Dr. Aishwarya, you had a meta-analysis. Again, well done, because of course, you know, what you have showed that occupational therapy works, and that reiterates that we are not wasting our time. We are doing something meaningful. And these things means a lot when policy decisions get made. So well done with that. Dr. Sadisha, about mental health, why I asked you that question is that it's just a coincidence. Last week, I had a meeting with the Chief Justice of Youth and Family Court in New Zealand. And he was thinking how to help prisoners or young offenders in prison to rehabilitate, and so that they do not do reoffense. Reoffense rate is very high, not only in New Zealand, all around the globe. And I'm sure it would be high in India as well. So your study has high potential. And on my program, which I'm leading, we have funded one remand home and one prison to do occupational therapy-based, sensory-based projects. So if you're interested to know more about that, I'll be happy to provide you more information or connect to the people who will be conducting those projects so that you can get some knowledge around, some information around that. And though you said that it was a small sample size, but I think it was a snapshot of really what the issues are. So really well done with that. The last one, Dr. Silpshri Palsule, I enjoyed listening to you, very confident and the way you presented, though we couldn't see you, but your voice was very, very confident and pleasant to hear too. You talked about the flaws, and it's really frustrating, isn't it? People who are supposed to do those work, they're not doing it properly. And if you'll give it to Arnab Goswami, I'm sure he will make a big news out of it. So well done. And well done for being brave and bold to present a paper like this in a national conference. And yes, so thank you very much. And that's all. Dr. Bijlani, it's over to you. You can take
it. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Harshvardhan. And it is over to Shreyash, who is, I know he's getting impulsive, and I don't know, because we are running out of time, and more than half an hour we are late. So over to Shreyash. Thank you, Shreyash, for giving us the opportunity and having here in this session. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, I'm really thankful to Dr. Jyotika Bijlani, ma'am, from allowing me to be the part of this OTCon 2021. And also to Dr. Harshvardhan, who's been always prompt in replying to all the mails sent and all the requests made. May it be judging, may it be chairing, and may it be presenting. It has been wonderful to listen to you at so many occasions, Dr. Harshvardhan. Thank you for chairing this session and enlightening each author with your wisdom. It was wonderful having you both here on this platform. Thank you, and enjoy your evening.
Thank you.